All right, well, it's time for episode number 23. And me, Chucky, as always, is here, along with Jiggity Jigsaw.
Indeed.
Another lineup of movies, and with one spectacular movie in there, I'm sure. What have we got for today?
We always have the most interesting lineups. So, first off, we have Dudley Blasting, 1981 Wes Craven movie. Then from 1990, Plage Night. Then we have a sequel to a movie we spoke about quite some time ago. We have Kickboxer 2, The Road Back from 1991.
One of the greatest movies of all time.
Indeed. Following that, a 1980 alien invasion type movie without warning. And then we finish off the night with a somewhat of a cult classic, House of a Thousand Corpses from 2003.
Well, let's get things started with Deadly Blessing, which is essentially about a woman who loses her husband due to a mysterious death, and she's just left to fend for herself against a bunch of Amish-type people with a leader who believes there's an incubus causing all the mayhem. I've seen this movie twice now. Both times, I had an okay time watching it. I didn't think it was necessarily anything all that special. I think the ending to the movie's sort of entertaining, and things really pick up there, but the majority of the movie, it just feels like it's in cruise control, and it's kind of moving along, and maybe it builds a little too slowly, I'm not sure, but it just, the majority of the movie just doesn't seem to really have any major highs or lows for me. So, it just, overall, just doesn't really feel all that special to me. I like the end, but that's about it.
Yeah, I feel like I mostly agree. I like the atmosphere throughout the movie. And just to, I guess, back up a little, I've never seen this one before. So I sort of went into this one not knowing much about it. No, I thought it was interesting concept. Like I said, it's a decent atmosphere, but it's just a bit slow moving. And I have a bit of arachnophobia, so the tarantula scenes, those somewhat terrifying.
Yeah, they've got a spider scene, they've got a snake scene.
And speaking of that snake scene, I sort of liked how it's pretty much the same from, it's same type of setup from Nightmare on Elm Street from a few years later.
Yeah, I was going to make the exact same point. Even the way it's filmed, it still reminds you a little bit of that scene from A Nightmare on Elm Street. Oh, obviously, this one came first, so I don't know if Wes Craven thought, you know, look, it looked good in this movie, let's try it in another movie. But yeah, no, it's, I mean, I've seen many snakes in my lifetime. I've even been chased by snakes up trees and things like that, so.
You've got to love Australia.
Yeah, that's just a typical weekend for us. But yeah, I mean, the snake scene's pretty intense. I assume most people not too fond of snakes, especially the dangerous ones.
Yeah, see, I'd say the snake scene didn't bother me. I mean, it was suspenseful, don't get me wrong, but like during the scenes with the tarantulas, and there I think there's three throughout the movie, like one, this woman looks up on her ceiling and there's a tarantula crawling and she just goes to sleep. If there's a tarantula crawling on my ceiling, I wouldn't be in that room. It just, like, I would not be there. So, you know, those scenes sort of stuck with me. I do think one of the best sequences in the movie was when one of the characters, I forget the woman's name, but it's one of the three women, goes into a barn to get something for the other woman. And then sort of like a 6-7 minute sequence where she's sort of trapped in the barn, being sort of chased and freaked out by this mysterious thing. And I don't know, I really liked the whole thing. Probably one of the most, in my opinion, one of the most suspenseful scenes in the movie.
Yeah, and the funny thing about this one is, Ernest Borgnine in the movie, I guess he does a decent job in the movie, but I'm mostly familiar with him from the movie Basketball. I'm not sure if you're familiar with that, but which is a comedy movie, and all the characters in it are pretty ridiculous to an extent. So I'm trying to watch him play this serious type character, and then all I can think about is his character from this other movie and all the silly stuff that that happens in that. It's just hard to take him seriously all the time.
So I was actually reading up about this movie after I watched it, and apparently he was nominated for, I think it was a Razzie Award for like being the worst, one of the worst side characters in the movie of 1981. It sort of like blew my mind because I actually thought he did a pretty decent job here.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe he was a bit, you know, stereotypical, stone, Hittite type guy, but I thought he did okay.
Yeah, I thought he did okay as well. I'm not too familiar with a lot of the other things that he's done, but obviously he's, you know, he's one of the more popular names in the movie, and I don't know, maybe, you know, in comparison to things that he's done previously, they saw this as a kind of a silly movie, but...
So, speaking of actors, I just wanted to point out, it's sort of nice seeing Michael Bayman in the movie. It sort of made sense because he was also in Hairs of Eyes, which is also a Wes Craven movie. So I sort of like how he brought him back, even though his role here wasn't like really substantial.
Yeah. All right, there's quite a few known names here, whether they're familiar to B-movie fans or horror movie fans or mainstream movie fans. I mean, even Sharon Stone's in the movie. I think it's one of her earlier films, maybe even her first film, I can't recall.
Yeah, it's funny because I know that's like a big talking point. At least I've seen it as a big talking point. I don't know who Sharon Stone is. Like, I've heard the name before. I have no idea who she is.
All I can think about, whenever I watch a movie with Sharon Stone, all I can think about is from Scream, where Matthew Lillard's saying, "Let's face it, she's no Sharon Stone." I think when I was talking about Sydney's mother or something like that. I even just loudly say it during the movie. "You know Sharon Stone." Yeah, and another thing, just the whole Amish-type presence in the movie, it just, once again, you know, other things that just taint the experience, I guess. I mean, there's that Weird Al Yankovic song where he does a parody of Gangster's Paradise.
It's a pretty fun song.
Amish Paradise, or whatever. Sell quilts at discount price. Yeah. So, you know, I'm constantly thinking of all these stupid, funny things unrelated to the movie. Well, I mean, you know, loosely related.
Yeah, I think what I was most interested in was there was, like, a line from one of the characters. You know, like, so, hey, these people like Amish people. It's like, oh, no, they're more hardcore. And I'm like, what made them more hardcore than most Amish people? I just didn't see it. Actually, on a fun side note, I used to live in a small village in New York, New York State, which actually was like had a pretty high Amish population. So it's a random jiggy fact. It has no relation to this movie. I wanted to mention about this movie. Toward the end, the movie becomes almost, it starts feeling more like a slasher in a way. And that really goes like full over the top slasher, but it gets a little more familiar. You know, I'm a big slasher fan, and it starts feeling a little more familiar to me. And toward the end, there's like a somewhat of a twist, which I thought was interesting. I'm not sure if it was really done all that well, but it was an interesting idea.
Yeah, I know when I looked this movie up the first time I watched it about a year or two ago, there were some people, you know, saying that the ending is kind of a mess or it doesn't make sense or all these kind of things. They had problems with it, and even though I'm not, I didn't really watch the movie with my brain switched on. Like I said, I'm thinking of all these things from Basketball and Amish Paradise and all this kind of stuff. I'm just all over the shop, so I'm not even. I mean, I'm following the story, but at the same time, I'm not really thinking too hard about connecting all the dots. You know, this is happening because of this and yada yada yada. So I didn't really care too much about whether the ending made complete sense or whatever it was. It was it just felt like a fairly entertaining ending. Like you said, there's a slasher aspect to it, which started to make things a little more enjoyable. And then also, yeah, that kind of... The thing that happens at the end, I won't spoil it, but
yeah,
we all know what kind of pops up there.
Admittedly, that ending, I thought was somewhat terrible. I mean, it just didn't make, in my opinion, it didn't make much sense compared to what happened before. But I mean, that's fine. I heard that Wes Craven didn't even really want that in the movie, but so the producer sort of made him do it. So it happens.
Ah, fuck it. Nah, it's entertaining. Leave it in. So, I mean, I think Deadly Blessing's an okay movie. It's a movie that I wouldn't mind probably seeing again, you know, another 5-10 years later, but I just didn't think it was all that special. Decent ending, but the majority of the movie just feels like it's kind of just moving along at a steady pace, not really doing too much. So I'll give it a 6 out of 10, and which is about an average rating for me.
Yeah, I enjoyed some aspects of this movie, but it didn't entirely work. It was an interesting concept, but there were some issues here. I think it's around average, so I'm just going to throw this one a 7 out of 10. And that may change if I see it again in the future, but I think for now, 7 out of 10 average sort of covers it.
Yeah, you may need to watch some more Sharon Stone movies.
I think I've only seen this one, so... Now, Sharon Stone was not in this next movie, Plage Night, or was she? But she wasn't. Plage Night is a interesting movie, 1990. Basically, there's this fraternity thing that happened in the past, and this Plage guy who was plaging for the two fraternity died, and like I think it's like 20 years later, he comes back and attacks the frat house, and these like bunch of Plages have to like try to survive and stuff. And I may not be doing the plot justice, but it's an entertaining movie. I wouldn't go as far as to call it necessarily a good movie, but it's certainly entertaining. I'm personally not a big fan of fraternities. I just...
You got your ass paddled at some point.
It's just... I have issues with fraternities, but... And actually, when I post my review, that's going to be like about 4 paragraphs, but for now... So the first 40 minutes or so, it's just going through different, just different hazing rituals. You know, quote-unquote harmless rituals, you know, just to make sure they're part of the team. So that part didn't really do that much for me, but eventually once the horror starts kicking in, and just to clarify, so sort of comedic horror, the guy who comes back, I think his name's Sid, He has like one-liners and stuff, none of which are particularly amusing, but he tries. So, what did you think about this one?
Yeah, this one's a bit all over the place for me. This is a first-time watch for me. When I first put the movie on, like, you know how the first couple of minutes you kind of get the impression of what the movie's going to be
yes.
like? Yeah. And the first couple of minutes I'm thinking, okay, this is... You know, I think I know what I'm gonna kind of get out of this movie. Probably a 6-7 out of 10 type movie. The way it looks, the way it's filmed, and then things start moving along, and they spend so much time hazing these dudes. I mean, first of all, I think like I said, with fraternities and pledging and hazing and all that kind of stuff, I think it's so stupid. It's so ridiculous. It's almost like, you know, the college students are just bored and this is something to do. And at times it's a bit homoerotic too. They're always like getting guys to bend over and paddle their asses and do all kinds of stuff. And, they spend quite a good portion of the first half of the movie just doing these things. Some of it's a little funny, but kind of wondering, okay, where's this going? And eventually...
I'm sorry. Okay. I just wanted to throw in one thing. One of my favorite lines in the movie was actually that one line before they go to sleep. Hey, maybe we should turn this light off as a group. Which that was probably the only thing in the movie that I found legitimately funny. So I guess kudos to that. But you may go on.
Yeah. So eventually it gets to a point where, okay, there's this one guy who's a lot unhinged. And I'm thinking, okay, so this is where they're going with it. That's fine. I think that's it's not too cliched, I guess. But it doesn't take long after that to suddenly go in a completely all new direction where things are just going crazy and it turns more into a silly cheesy, well, it was always kind of silly and cheesy, but they really max out on it after that at that point. And I don't think I really liked the way that it finally went, like the direction that it finally went in.
Yeah, the ending's a bit iffy in my opinion.
Yeah, it's if you're into it just to watch it like a cheesy kind of late 80s-ish type horror movie. I know it's 1990, but I'm guessing it was filmed late 80s because it still has a bit of an 80s vibe to it. You know, some people will find it just entertaining just based on the whole cheesy aspect of it, but I didn't really enjoy too much of... I just kind of felt like the movie kind of spent half the time not really going anywhere, then it started going in a direction which I thought, okay, that's decent. I was expecting it to just be like one of the guys just a bit crazy and, you know, that and that's the angle they're going with, and then they throw in another thing on top, and then yeah, it just got too silly for me to really appreciate it.
Yeah, if they had gone with just this guy going slowly more and more insane and like breaking down and starting, you know, killing people and like a normal slasher, I probably would have liked it a bit more, as opposed to like some, you know, demonic zombie type demon guy coming back. It just, yeah, I didn't care much for that whole thing. That said, I personally, I mean, even though the movie's not necessarily good, and even though, you know, I hate the one-liners, I still found the movie somewhat entertaining. And I actually have seen this one before back, I think it was 2017. And I think, you know, same thing, I found it entertaining. It's not a great movie, but I don't know, I had an okay enough time with it. It's nothing special, but, you know, it's a 90s movie that feels like an 80s movie. What's not to like besides, you know, stuff that you don't like?
Yeah, I mean, there's one or two decent deaths in the movie, if that's the type of thing you're looking for. But yeah, overall, it just didn't. It wasn't consistently good for me. There was moments where I was sort of enjoying it. There was a good portion of the movie where I'm just kind of waiting for something to happen, and then all this stuff happens at the end. But it just went completely in the wrong direction for me. This is the second movie that we're discussing for the show, and already another movie with a bathtub scene. Man, those nipples were really hard.
I didn't catch the woman's name, because I think there are like three women in here. They all pretty much look the same. But I was definitely okay with that scene.
I don't know how people get their nips so hard. That was like the most thought-provoking thing in the movie.
And it's unfortunately potentially true. Although I guess my thought-provoking thing is, who the hell is protesting back in the 60s and then goes to a fraternity? Like, that does not seem to me to be the same type of demographic. So, the movie is interesting, it's entertaining, but it's nothing special. That said, if it sounds like your type of thing, you know, you could do a lot worse. I'm going to throw this one a 6.5, which is just below average, but I'm probably just going to round it up to a 7. It's not great, but it can be an okay time.
Yeah, I'm probably going to go with a 5 for this one, 5 out of 10. Even though there's a few amusing parts here and there, a good portion of the movie just, you know, it's just watching dudes get pegged on their ass, and they have all kinds of stupid hazing stuff happen to them, and it's just so stupid. The plot twist closer to the end is just stupid. You can sit down and enjoy it if you're after something just... something kind of dumb and cheesy, but let's just move on. Fuck it. Anyways, on to obviously the best movie of today's show, Kickboxer 2 from 1991. So the story for this one centers around David, a brother of Kurt and Eric Sloan from the first movie. He's struggling to keep his gym open, and an opportunity comes along to work for an upcoming kickboxing federation, but he doesn't care so much He doesn't care much for them because he's a bit of a purist and thinks they're sucking the life out of the sport that he loves with drugs and crooked play and all that kind of stuff. So eventually we find out that some ruthless Thai businessmen are using the association to scope out David for a revenge match with the evil Tong Po in an attempt to regain their honor from the brutal loss suffered to Kurt Sloan in the first film. I mean, it's no secret to you and to a bunch of other people who probably listen by now that this is one of my all-time favorite movies. And I also enjoy the original movie, but I still think this one's way better. For a number of reasons I'm sure I'll get to. In fact, before I get to all those reasons, I'll just get your general thoughts on the movie first.
I thought it was decent.
That's your general thought. Yeah, it was decent.
I mean, yeah, movie was... I'll just say it like this. I can't help but compare the Kickboxer and Bloodsport series because I'm watching all these movies around the same time. And I would say this movie is definitely better than Bloodsport 2 was. So, there you go.
Well, that's good to hear. Yeah, I mean, I could pull out a whole lot of different things about the movie that that I like more than the original. I mean, okay, let's start with the soundtrack. I think the soundtrack for this one, there's some really good songs here, and I think at least the first song and the last song in the movie were written for the movie, or at least you can't find them anywhere else. The only place you can find them is in this movie. So, you know, the opening song really gets you fired up. And then it also has a nice rock song at the end as well. And not just the songs, but also the music that they play throughout the movie. I think it's all constructed quite well. Did you have any thoughts on the music? Or are you just like, I didn't really pay attention?
I did have a big issue with it. But, I mean, to me, it just felt like a lot of, generic 80s, music, some for South, some for us, I mean, I did have a problem with it, but it didn't strike me as anything particularly special, aside from that song at the end, which I did sort of like.
So the lead actor in it, Sasha Mitchell, who plays David Sloan, the funny thing is I can't remember if I watched this movie before or after seeing the original movie. I can't recall, but I saw both at a very young age, and I saw this one when it was a new release. I remember renting it out on VHS and watching it with my dad. And I guess, Sasha Mitchell's character in the movie is someone that I saw as a bit of a role model. He's a bit of a clean-cut guy with good values. And I always saw him as, he's someone, type of character that I wanted to be like, growing up as a kid. Which is kind of funny because I know you haven't seen any of the other sequels, but his character is so different in every other movie in the franchise. In part 3, he's a bit more like this character that he plays in the 90s sitcom Step by Step. Are you familiar with that show?
Unfortunately not.
Sasha Mitchell in that show, he kind of plays kind of like a dumb but lovable type character, easily the most popular character on the show. And he's a lot more like that in Kickboxer 3. He's a little more funnier. He's got a bit of a silly side to him. And then in part 4, he completely flips the script and he goes all dark and brooding. all three different movies that he's in this series, his character just feels different. But that's neither here nor there. But another big thing that people... people who enjoy the original movie in this series, they really don't like the fight scenes in this movie. I could look at YouTube videos and some people would be like, oh, look at this horrible fight choreography. And
I guess my only comment on that, I do think the slow motion was a bit much.
Yeah, there's a couple of reasons for that. And I believe it's because... I think a part of it, they needed to pad the runtime a little bit.
I can see that.
But not necessarily that was something they were doing from the outset, but they had to cut certain scenes in the movie as well. Apparently there was a fight scene with in the middle of the movie, the flashback sequence where they show Tong Po murdering Kurt Sloan. they were actually meant to have a fight, and there's rumors that that fight was actually way better than any other fight in the movie, so they decided to cut it because they didn't want the best fight to not be at the end. So that's a rumor. I've never seen any footage of that. People claim there's a VHS out there that has it, but I call bullshit on it, because if there was, it'd be up on YouTube by now. I mean, the movie's almost 30 years old. We would have seen this footage by now. I don't believe it exists. I've even tried to get the answers from the director. He didn't really give me too much info about it. But anyways, the fight choreography in the movie, it's done by Benny Urquidez, who I believe is an undefeated kickboxer. And he's also done fight scenes in movies. He's even had a fight scene against Jackie Chan in one movie. If you ever watch, like, a real kickboxing match, it's not all that entertaining unless, you know, you're a purist, like someone who enjoys the actual martial art aspect of it. But if you're in it just to see someone get their ass kicked, it's not exactly the most entertaining type of fight you can watch. So I will say that, and I know this is the thing he was trying to do in the movie, is to make it feel like more of a real kickboxing match. Whereas you see the original movie, you got Van Damme doing all these fancy kicks and splits and stuff. The type of shit you never see in a real kickboxing match. And it may make for a less entertaining fight, but at the same time, I think it makes maybe a little more realistic.
Yeah, I will say, the scene in which they sort of trick the guy into coming to watch his friend fight... That whole scene, when the guy was just getting beat down, that was pretty painful to watch.
Yeah. And that actually reminds me, there was a... I don't know who it was, but there was a quote at some point, sort of recently, from, like, a UFC fighter. I don't know if it was a boxer or a UFC fighter, but it was basically saying, you know, we're in a sport where... one of the few places where you can legally kill someone... Like, just by, you know, hitting them really hard, you can kill them. I mean, and that's basically what happens here. I mean, technically, even though you can kill someone in the ring for beating the shit out of them, it's not really illegal. So, I just thought that was kind of an interesting thing to think about. Well, I mean, obviously, if you go too far and you're really reckless and careless. So, I mean, he was in this movie, but...
Yeah, I would say, like, picking up the referee and throwing him out of the room might have been a problem.
Yeah. But, I mean, if he didn't do all those things and he still killed the guy, you know, there's not much he could have really done about it. But I can't help but compare some things, obviously, from this movie to the original movie, and things about this movie that I like more. Like, the end scene is... The end fight to this movie is actually quite bloody, and I mean, you're fighting with shards of glass on your hand. I expect it to be bloody, and they did the same thing in the original movie, but there wasn't all that much blood. There was just one or two cuts here and there, nothing major. So that's another thing I really enjoyed. You know, there's a lot of blood-soaked mayhem in that last fight.
I also like seeing the, I forget the character's name, but the guy in the suit, I like seeing his ass get kicked too, that was good stuff.
Yeah. There's a lot of notable veteran-type actors in this movie as well. You may or may not be familiar with Peter Boyle, but...
Yes, I have seen quite a bit of everybody last Raymond.
Yeah, yeah.
And also, too, he doesn't look any different here, by the way.
No. Maybe a few less wrinkles, but pretty much the same. And yeah, like you said, the one guy gets his ass kicked in the suit, Kerry Tagawa. He's been in a long list of movies. You know, he was Shang Tsung in Mortal Kombat, which a lot of people, you know, a lot of people bring that up. But he's been in a long list of movies as well. And even the... he kind of, like, plays David's accountant, or whatever you want to call him in this movie, John Deal. I don't know if you're familiar with the Angel movies from the 80s. I think it's from the 80s.
I've heard about them, I've never actually seen them.
Yeah. He plays... I've only seen the original one once, but he plays like a maniac type slasher character in it. He's like the bad guy in it. And from what I remember, he played a pretty intense slasher type character. I should check out that movie again, but it's just kind of weird to see him do something completely different. But yeah, and another thing, just, I mean, I'm just rattling off from a list of things that I think this movie does better. But like the villain Tong Po in this movie, played by the same actor, in this movie they don't need to really do anything to make him scary. He's pretty intimidating. Where, you know, he kind of just stares at you, he kind of moves a bit like a Terminator, you know, he'll let you hit him around a bit, and doesn't look like it phases him at all.
He doesn't have much of an emotional depth.
Yeah, he almost feels like he's got the look of a human, but he just feels like he isn't there. Like, you know, he doesn't really care if he kills you or what. And in the original movie, just a couple of things that don't really hurt my enjoyment of the original, but in the original they make him a rapist, they fix the final fight. The fact that they fix the final fight, to me, I know they just want to secure the win, but at the same time it shows a little bit of uncertainness about, you know, they're not all that confident that he's going to win, I guess. You know, you should expect the bad guy to be the favorite. And in this movie, it, no pun intended, it's more of a David and Goliath type thing. David Sloan.
Okay.
That's where the pun potentially came from there. But when you think about it, the bad guy in this movie, he comes in, he's all in shape, he's fighting a guy who is clearly not as skilled as Van Damme's character from the first movie, but at the same time he's also still sort of recovering from a pretty terrible leg injury. So you're going into the fight thinking he'd probably get his ass kicked and potentially killed. I mean, in the original Kickboxer, you kind of go in, I mean, if you just look at Van Damme, he's got muscles popping out of every part of his body, even out of his neck and stuff. But he looks like he's just going to go in and fucking kick some ass and maul the guy, which I guess is why they needed to blackmail him. But I just think, even though it's a little cliched, you know, the hero being the underdog, I think it's always good to see the underdog come over on top at the end.
I mean, I will say one thing that somewhat disappointed me. I don't think they spent nearly enough time on, like, the training sequences. You know, I liked the little bit that we got, but, you know, that made up a, you know, somewhat large portion of the first movie. And the character, you know, the Asian guy who's training him, I forget his name right now. You know, it was nice seeing him again, but I don't know if he really brought as much to this movie as he did the first one.
He brought the comic relief.
Some comic relief.
It's got half price tickets to Disneyland.
That was a nice opening line.
What about the part where he's like, if you don't want me to tell the story, you must make me stop. And he's like, fine, tell me the stupid story about this stupid fucking mouse. And he's like, very well, if you insist.
Admittedly, I did crack up during that line.
Another just notable thing that you may find interesting. You remember, well, right towards the beginning of the movie, there's that one kid who is, you know, taking swings at David while he's blindfolded.
Indeed.
You remember that? Yeah. That's Brian Austin Green, who you may remember from the movie Chrome Skull. You know, the guy who gets a tattoo at the end?
Huh, that's that guy? Huh.
Yeah, that's him. I don't know, just amusing to see people so young and then you match them to some movie they've been in more recently. And
yeah, I nodded in a trillion years with regards to that.
Yeah, I just thought you'd appreciate that. But
I think he did better in this movie than he did in the film cut.
Well, he got a lot less screen time, so maybe that's it.
Although, that reminds me, like, the whole, like, sort of cliche and, like, you know, everything's good again. I don't want to spoil too much about this movie if you haven't seen it, but the ending to the first movie, it seems like it's everything's okay. Then we watch this movie, and we found out that a sizable amount of people from the first movie are just gone, which, sort of really puts a depressing tone on that.
Yeah, well, see, the thing is, Van Damme was originally meant to be in this movie. Well, I guess one of the things to highlight is the guy that wrote this movie went on to write, a lot of big movies. Yeah, so David Goyer, he's a very popular writer now in Hollywood. So, and this is either his first or second movie that he wrote. I can't recall exactly which one, but I think it might have been his second. But apparently Van Damme took a liking to him and asked him to write this movie. And then eventually, I don't... It's never really fully come out as to exactly why Van Damme wasn't in it, but I believe it's because of the money. It's not a very big budget movie, this one, and at that point he was actually starting to really make a lot of money in Hollywood, and partially I think, scheduling conflicts with other movies he was filming where he was making a lot more money, that would have played into it as well. So eventually, even though he got David Goyer to write this movie, he eventually dropped out of the movie. So I guess they, had to write it for a completely different character. Now I've actually got one of Goyer's original scripts for this movie. One of the few rare people in the world to have it. So that just shows how big of a fan I am of it. But in one of the original versions of the script, and I think a lot of people actually don't know this, there's a lot of mention in that script about David kind of being more like a adopted brother, not an actual blood brother.
Yeah, actually, I was going to ask, was it mentioned in the first movie that there was another brother?
No, a lot of people cling to this one scene early in the original Kickboxer where the two brothers are talking about, one spent his time with their dad, and the other spent most of his time with their mum, and they just don't mention a brother. So a lot of people are like, well, if they had a brother, they would have mentioned him there, which, I mean, yeah, maybe, but I think they still get away with
I
it.
mean, I it's a difficult situation, if especially if it was planned for Van Damme to come back. So I mean, I get, once the movie came out, there's nothing they could really do to fix it.
Yeah. And I mean, the guy that plays Tong Po in this movie, originally he wasn't in the script, and eventually I think maybe I don't know if it was because Van Damme wasn't in, they asked him if he wanted to be in it, and I don't think he actually really liked so much how this movie was written, but he wanted to be in it just because in the original movie he never got his actual name credited. Like his actual stage name. They called him Tong Po in the credits. No one knows who Tong Po is. It's a fictional character. So in this movie, he actually got his stage name in the credits to actually make a bit of a name for himself.
Yeah, I feel like if you don't, especially him not getting his name in the crowd that's in the first movie, you could say that's a kick in the face.
Yeah, well, he said the. They asked him to do it, and he agreed to it just, because he was young and he didn't want to, rub anyone the wrong way, and because sometimes when you do that, it affects you getting work in the future. So, anyways, that's mainly why he came back and did this movie, because he'd finally get his name in the credits of a pretty big, well, somewhat big movie, because this movie did get played at the theaters, at least in a bit of a limited run, so that's why he did that.
How many times have you seen this movie?
This week? Oh, jeez. We're going up near the 100 mark, I think. Yeah, it's, I don't know, it maybe I've broken 100 views, I don't know, but it's
That's
up
like
there.
10 times a year.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's been out for almost 30 years, so, that's 3 or 4 times a year. I mean, but well, back then when it came out, I didn't exactly have it on VHS. Buying movies back then was a lot more difficult to do. Yeah, no, I've seen it a lot. Anyways, we've probably talked about this one for a long time. I can hear the itching you really want to get to without warning.
Oh boy.
So I'll just go ahead and read it. So it's my all-time favorite non-horror movie. It's right up there with Child's Play, my all-time favorite movie. So I give it a 10 out of 10. I don't need to go through too much more about why I like it. I think I've spent 20 plus minutes talking about that. And I'll leave it to you for your rating.
Yeah, so I enjoyed this movie. I mean, I had a good enough time with it. I did like it as much as the first movie. But it was still an okay movie. And like I said, it's nowhere near as bad as the Saga of Lodzport was. So I'm just going to give this one, like, I think 7 out of 10. Like, which is an average rating for me. I mean, it's an okay movie. I wouldn't necessarily go out of my way to see it again anytime soon, but I mean, it's fine. It's nothing, like, majorly wrong with it. It just wasn't quite as installing as the first one was, so there you go.
That's a woman's bullshit rating.
Next up, we have a somewhat interesting movie, Without Warning, from 1980. And the plot's pretty simple. This is sort of alien creatures. They sort of like look like frisbees. They have like tentacles on them. Some good stuff. They are attacking people near this foresty lake area, and they try to fight back. And it's good stuff. I saw this one once before, maybe about 5 years ago, and I remember, at least back then, I remember sort of liking it. So I watched it just earlier tonight. And, like, I could barely stay awake during it. Like, there's some interesting things, and I actually think this partial effects are decent. Like, once this alien gets on you, sort of, like, latches onto your skin, and I thought it was decent partial effects, but this story here just plods along, and it just took some real power to sit through. There's some pretty big names in the movie, but I don't know if that really helps much. What do you think about this one?
Yeah, I'm kind of in the same boat there. The effects are pretty decent. Whenever you see one of those little things get attached to whoever and starts sucking or whatever it's doing, you know, those moments were entertaining. Even though that noise that it kept making kind of drove me a bit nuts after a while. But even though it's got a few big names in it, we got Jack Palance and Martin Landau.
Which is funny, because both of them were also in Alone in the Dark, which is a movie that we talked about months ago.
That's a movie that you really enjoy, but I personally found a bit eh. And I don't know if it's those actors, but I mean, Jack Palance just feels like he's the same in every movie. I know him best just in a small supporting role in Tim Burton's Batman. I've seen him in other things, but that's where I'm most familiar with him from. And every other time where I see him in a role where he's more of a lead character, I can really only think of Alone in the Dark, but I'm sure there's one or two others that I've seen. Yeah, the movies just never really take off for me. Same with Martin Landau, decent actor, just I've more enjoyed him in smaller roles than being a lead character. But there's big portions of this movie where I'm just not interested in the characters, and they spend a lot of time, you know, what's this guy's story? What's this guy's story? And I just didn't really care about them. And eventually we get to some, like, alien action towards the end, which is somewhat entertaining. But I don't really want to go through all that character development, because the characters just really didn't interest me at all.
I will say, I did like Martin Landau as Sarge. I liked the whole PTSD thing he was going through, which added a little, you know, just a little something interesting in the movie, which was otherwise, like I said, it's just somewhat tedious.
Whenever I see those things flying at people, oh, it's like someone threw a pizza crust at someone. Especially at the end when the alien throws it at them, it feels like he just threw a piece of pizza at someone. I don't know. They did mention something about an alien hunting for sport. I mean, obviously, if you're after a movie where an alien's hunting people for sport, go
this
with
is
Predator.
The best one.
Go with Predator. I mean, that's what Predator is, and Predator's leagues ahead of this movie. I mean, yeah, there's little bits and pieces of this movie that I like, but like I said, there's just so much time spent just dealing with characters that I just have no interest in, and it just made a lot of the movie uninteresting. Not necessarily boring, just uninteresting to me.
Yeah, one thing I found sort of amusing is, you know, these two kids, their friends died, and these two kids are trying to survive, and, like, within the last 50 minutes, one of the kids who is, you know, alive through, like, the whole movie just dies. At first I thought it was, like, a dream sequence, but no, it's like he's actually dead. I'm like, oh, okay, there's some good time spent on him. He was a very interesting character, don't get me wrong, it's no great loss, but it just struck me as an interesting choice.
To be honest, I think I've summed up my thoughts on this movie.
Well, to quote the poster, it preys on human fear and it feeds on human flesh. Even though we never saw that, but that's okay. Without warnings, it's an interesting movie in a way, but it's just boring. Like, it's an 80s movie, but it feels a lot more like a 70s movie, in my opinion. And, like I said, there's some decent names in here, some, you know, big actors, and I sort of like seeing them. I just wish they were doing a bit more. So, I mean, I'll just give this one a go, but just don't expect, like, anything that amazing. I'm going to throw this one, I think I'm going to throw, like, a 5.5, and I guess I can round it up to a 6 to be generous, but, I mean, it's just not a great movie. It's okay, it's just not great, and it's only okay in the vaguest of definitions, so.
Yeah, I'm a little torn on what to rate this one. I'm flipping somewhere between a 4 and a 5. Since I watched it in not such a great quality presentation, I'll give it the benefit of the doubt, and I'll give it a 5. I wish we had seen that alien creature a little bit more, rather than just right at the end. I mean, we see it just a little bit earlier in the movie, but yeah, it just spends way too much time with characters that I just had no interest in. I like the effects. I like some of the little scenes where it's kind of like ripping off Alien to a degree with the face huggers, but not on the face. That was entertaining. That's all I really got. Moving on to the final movie for today, Rob Zombie's House of 1,000 Corpses, from 2003. These two young couples traveling across the backwoods of Texas searching for urban legends of murder and end up as prisoners of a bizarre and sadistic backwater family of serial killers. I originally saw this one in the theaters to a pretty raucous crowd, I guess you could say, where people are throwing their M&Ms and not necessarily to do anything with the movie, just I think there was a lot of assholes in the crowd. I had mixed thoughts about the movie originally. I kind of liked it to a degree, but I still had reservations about how much I liked it. And then I've seen it a bunch of times since, and the last time I watched it, which was maybe a few weeks back, I had a really good time with it. I think especially with the Captain Spaulding scenes, you know, Sid Haig's character in the movie is just all kinds of entertaining. Unfortunately, the majority of his scenes are towards the beginning. Not to say that the other characters aren't interesting themselves. He's just the best character in the movie.
Yeah, I'm much in the same vein. The first, like, 3 or 4 times I saw this movie, I didn't really care for it that much. You know, I was a kid at the time, it just seemed so random. Like, the random clips thrown in that have no context and no relation to the actual plot. You know, it's just too weird for me at the beginning. But the more I watched this, the more I sort of appreciated the style. You know, I know that some people think it's a bit much, but I don't know, it just adds something special to the movie. You know, it just, very, you know, random, interesting stuff. Some of it's like ramblings from the Firefly family members. You know, and some of it's like people talking about this woman who had low relations with a skunk ape and stuff. It's like all over the place, but it's never boring. Then, of course, you know, there's a lot of memorable characters. like Captain's Paladin, like Otis, who's very striking, I think is a very interesting character. And then by the end of like Dr. Satan, like it's just, and that whole ending is like a complete wild ride. So I don't know, I think there's a lot in this movie you really appreciate, and I definitely like it a lot more nowadays than I used to.
Yeah, I mean, there's characters all over the place in this one. It does seem a little messy. I know there was a lot of production type issues going on as well in terms of the movie getting released, so I think that probably attributed to it a little. One of the characters in the movie that I kind of really enjoy, well, you don't get to see too much of him, but I think his name was Earl. He's basically like, he kind of looks like the guy from My Bloody Valentine, but on steroids. Like a mutated version of, what's his name? Henry Warden, is that it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, it's just, I can't remember if he had a pickaxe or not, but he just had a very similar look, but obviously much huger. That moment when you kind of see a guy like that coming after you, like, oh shit. I'm so surprised that she managed to kind of get away from him. He just looked like he was on the warpath.
Yeah, I think probably one of the most striking moments in the movie, and there are quite a few, but that scene in which the detectives at the Firefly house, once interviewing or trying to interview the mother, the other two are sort of trying to look for any evidence of wrongdoing, and then it hits like they find some stuff, and then it hits like a sort of a slow motion when there's like a really slow moving sound in the background, and it just like, all out chaos, and sort of a happy sound playing, and it just ends in like a pretty tense, I'm like, oh my god, is this guy, going to shoot him? And of course he does. It's just a very nice scene.
The pause in that is just, it's even a little much, perhaps, but
it should have been twice as long.
It was like at least 30 seconds. Where you're almost wondering if the movie's somehow, frozen.
Yeah, I sort of wonder how people in the theaters reacted to that. Like, they're just, like, sitting there for the first 10 seconds, like, wait, is he actually going to do anything? It's something.
Plot twist, the next 20 minutes is just this one frame.
I think eventually people would leave, but... and also, this is a controversial opinion. I actually sort of like Sherry Moon in this movie. Her character and Baby is, I mean, she's obviously batshit insane, but she's interesting. She's novel, not entertaining. But, I think she does the character justice.
Yeah.
Now, that said, I still much prefer either Otis or Captain Spaulding, but, I mean, Baby was okay.
Yeah, I think she's fine in this movie as well. And I'm guessing you haven't seen the most recent one, Three from Hell.
I have not seen that one yet. Though I've heard pretty underwhelming things.
Well, I think there's a lot of mixed feelings on that one. I personally thought it was pretty decent. And especially Sherry Moon's character in it. I think she was actually... Her scenes are probably the more entertaining in the movie. She really plays a whole mentally insane type thing pretty well in that movie. But anyways, I won't talk too much about that.
And also one thing that really strikes me about this movie. And like the first few times I saw this movie, it just seems so strange. But toward the end, there's a few characters alive and they're sort of marched out to like sort of like a burial type thing. There's like this sort of electronic industrial music playing, and it's like they get lowered into this pit in the coffin, and it just the whole thing is somewhat creepy, especially with like this like I think it's like a tape recorder, and it keeps saying like you will bury me in an unnamed grave and stuff, and it's very very dark feeling, and of course from that point on, like it becomes almost like more psychedelic than it had been before, which I thought was sort of impressive.
It's a pretty unconventional movie. And that, I think that helps to really make it stand out. I mean, even to this day, it there's not a whole lot of movies you could say that are like this one. And, I mean, for anyone who actually owned the original DVD, probably the best DVD menu of all time.
Which DVD menu are we talking about?
It's the one where Captain Spaulding's basically talking a bunch of shit while you're waiting to select something.
Yeah, that is the DVD I have, and it just cracks me up.
Yeah, I can't remember. I still have. I mean, the Australian DVD has the exact same menu, and I've still got that DVD, even though I've got the Blu-ray as well.
Like, every time I pick the DVD, and I just want to watch the whole thing. Yeah. But, you know, I know I'm under time constraints, so I have to watch the movie, but I just want to keep watching him talk to us. It's just fun stuff.
If it, I'm assuming someone's put it on YouTube by now, but if they haven't, I can always rip the DVD menu off and upload it myself.
Yeah, it's very, like, quality. You don't see things like that often. They definitely went above and beyond with that DVD copy.
I mean, they obviously filmed that stuff in anticipation for it, so it's some good thinking ahead of time.
Now, out of interest, is this one of your favorite Rob Zombie movies, or do you like Davis Rejects more?
I think I like this more than The Devil's Rejects. I still think Devil's Rejects is decent as well, but I'd probably go with this one just because it's a little more, it's got more of a horror aspect to it. How do you feel?
I don't disagree that this has a much more horror aspect. It's more like after a while. I've always been, like I said, I used to not like this one nearly as much as I do now. But I've always liked the Davis Rejects for, I mean, it's a lot more conventional, but I think it's a very solid movie. And both of them are very high above average. But no, I always lean toward Davis Rejects, but I enjoy both of them.
Yeah, I think most people probably tend to lean towards Devil's Rejects, but over time, like I said, I think House of a Thousand Corpses is actually catching up a little.
Yeah, and I know that when this came out, there's a lot of like mixed feelings toward it. And, you know, over the last few years, well, I guess the last 10 years, I've been hearing more and more positive things about it. So I am happy that it's finally sort of receiving, I guess, you know, a lot more, I guess, respect toward it. I am giving this one an 8.5 out of 10. And I had to think about this for a while. I'm probably going to round that down to an 8. But it's totally it's definitely a movie that's above average. Very interesting movie. And even if you don't like the movie, like, you know, like I said, first 3-4 times I saw it, I didn't really like it that much. Even if you don't like it, you're not going to forget it.
Mm.
So, I mean, I don't know, it's definitely a movie that I enjoy. I had a blast watching it again. I watched it a few days ago, first time I saw it in like 2 or 3 years, so I had a blast doing that. And it's just a really fun movie, good stuff, would recommend.
Yeah, I'm going to give it an 8. I have pretty much the exact same thoughts. I think it's a movie that's gotten a bit better with age. It's got a lot of interesting characters. Captain Spaulding's really cool, really funny. Yeah, it's a good mixture of comedy and uneasy moments, and obviously a lot of batshit crazy horror stuff. So, you know, it's got a lot of stuff going for it, and I just think it's a really entertaining movie.
That's sad, we could both be wrong, so if you want to tell us how wrong we are, let us know.
We're not wrong.
Okay.
I'm never wrong. I don't know about this guy.
I am often wrong if you read any of my reviews, but
yeah.